Racism and the minimal group paradigm. Have you ever wondered why there is so much racism in the world? It seems that everywhere you look, folks in the majority or in power pick on other folks just because they're different and subject them to horrendous treatment, even threaten their lives for no apparent reason. Whatever for? There is actually a body of evidence from sociological research going back 5 decades that sheds light on this question. While we could spend days discussing all the dimensions of this complex topic, in the next few minutes I would like to discuss just one, the minimal group paradigm. The earliest study using the minimal group paradigm was done in 1971. 48 teenage boys were recruited to participate in what they believed to be a study of art appreciation. Each boy was shown a series of paintings in pairs and was asked to identify which painting he preferred. Once finished, the boys were told that one picture in each pair was painted by Paul Klee and the other by Vasily Kandinsky, two well-known European painters. Half the boys were falsely told that they preferred Klee paintings, and the other half were told they preferred Kandinsky. Actually, the researchers had randomly assigned the boys into the two groups in a way that had nothing to do with the paintings. But in each boy's eyes, he now belonged to either a Klee group or a Kandinsky group. The sham artist's preference was the minimal characteristic that defined the groups, a trivial distinction that wasn't even true. Instantly, the boys developed a powerful allegiance to their own group. In a second part of the experiment, each boy showed a strong tendency to reward members of his group and to penalize members of the other group, even if he did not know them personally. This tendency toward favoritism based on a trivial difference became known as the minimal group bias and was repeatedly confirmed by countless experiments. It hardly mattered how one divided subjects into groups. Flip a coin, heads versus tails, dress up the subjects, blue shirts versus red shirts. In every case, as soon as groups were defined, the subjects would favor their own team, the in-group, with positive impressions and rewards. And they would predictably discriminate against the out-group with negative opinions and penalties. The tendency to discriminate appeared even in children under the age of 4. The power of this trend was tested by additional experiments to see how far subjects would go to discriminate against the out-group. In one study, 186 white college students were charged with a hypothetical task. They were told that the state regents would be donating a sum of money to support both white and minority student organizations around the state. The allocation of funds between the two types of organizations had not been set, and the white students were asked to choose from several possibilities. At one extreme, the subjects could select an option in which both types of organizations would be highly compensated, but the white organizations would receive somewhat less than the minority groups. The middle choice was that both groups would get much less funding, but the amount would be equal, $13 million apiece. At the other extreme, the funds would be severely limited, but the award assignments would be flipped. Minority groups would get the smaller share. This option went by the nickname Vladimir's Choice, the tendency to maintain dominance at one's own expense. The name derived from an old Russian fable in which God granted Vladimir, a peasant, a single wish for anything he wanted. The only catch was that his wish would be doubled for his neighbor, Ivan. Vladimir was quick to respond. In that case, take out one of my eyes. In the student experiment, only 11% of subjects chose to maximize their income, which would have meant giving the minority groups an advantage. The most common choice actually was the middle one, to allocate $13 million to each group. Of course, this meant that they accepted less for themselves so as not to give their rivals the edge. But 16% of students made Vladimir's choice, accepting $12 million less for themselves to maximize the distinction between the two groups. In other words, to dominate. Wow. There is much to digest here, so let's summarize. We all want to be in a group, on a team. We will jump at a chance to identify with a group no matter how trivial the entry requirement. Once we are in a group, we will immediately develop powerful loyalties to fellow members whom we will favor and will express negative impressions of outsiders whom we will discriminate against, whether we know them personally or not. We will seek to maximize the edge the in-group has over the out-group by limiting rewards to the out-group even at our own expense in order to maintain dominance. And we will express these tendencies early in life, even when we are barely past the toddler stage. That sounds a lot like my fanatical bias about professional football teams. I do love the Philadelphia Eagles, my home team, but I also despise the Dallas Cowboys, our rivals. Their players are overrated and their fans are a bunch of hooligans. All this is a complete fiction, of course, but I would almost rather see the Eagles lose than see the Cowboys win. Just call me Vladimir. The minimal group paradigm certainly explains a lot of human behavior in sports, politics, school, and the workplace. Almost everywhere we turn, we find ourselves defined by the groups we belong to, including some heavy hitters like gender, religion, and political party. Small wonder that it is so difficult for us all to get along. And now I understand better why Republicans stick with Trump despite his obvious shortcomings. He's on their team, and that counts for a lot. But of all the traits that define us, none seem so powerful as race. I'm not sure if that is because race is so visually apparent or because of the powerful impact of race in human history. In any case, race appears to elicit the strongest reactions of mistrust, discrimination, dominance, and abuse. There is so much to say about racism, and I'm not qualified to say it, but one thing is clear to me. The tendency to mistrust and discriminate against those who are different than ourselves is inborn. Not all of us grow up to be explicitly racist, but it is our natural tendency to lean in that direction, and it doesn't take much nurturing to bring out our worst. After all, the teenage boys and the college students in the bias studies are no different than all the rest of us. And while we can mitigate this unfortunate tendency by good parenting and socialization, it is baked into our DNA. It is both a natural trait and a biological defect. We ignore that fact at our peril. I'm sure there was a time in our cave-dwelling days when trusting only in your tribe and mistrusting outsiders gave you a survival advantage. But in today's interconnected world, group identities create divisions and sow discord that weakens our communities and brings unspeakable harm to those unfortunate enough to be in the out-group. And when the group identity is race, our natural tendencies can lead to unimaginable acts of hate and harm, such as the violence inflicted against George Floyd, Eric Garner, and Trayvon Martin. Knowing that the tendency to discriminate against those who are different is inborn helps us appreciate how insidious is the worst side of our human nature and how important it is to overcome that tendency through active parenting, schooling, and socialization. Most importantly, it enables us to recognize that the people throughout history who have written our laws and designed our economic systems, overwhelmingly white people, have been influenced by the same inclination to protect the power of other white people. After 246 years of slavery and 89 years of segregation, the modern-day racial disparities we see in everything from maternal mortality to incarceration rates are evidence of how far we still need to go. For that reason, it is not enough not to be racist. It is essential to work actively to be anti-racist. Because if we let up for a moment, it would be all too easy to slip back into the worst versions of ourselves. There is one more very important reason we should take this lesson to heart. Since the tendency for individuals to fall into the trap of class affinity, team loyalty, and group alliance is so inbred, so powerful, and so irresistible, it takes very little effort to tether it to almost any perverse aim. Some of the worst despots in history did exactly that. Indeed, President Trump makes no apology for his repeated attempts to tug and poke at the fault lines of race, religion, and country of origin as he harnesses group bias for his own purposes. If this were to remain unchecked, there is no telling where we might wind up. It is up to us to counter this egregious approach to national leadership in the election of 2020. Please do not forget to vote. Hi, I'm Nate Link, and I hope you were enlightened by this video essay on racism and the minimal group paradigm. For more video essays on economics, health, and national leadership, please check out my website at snickersnack.com.